This Equipment World video is brought to you by Chevron Delo 600 ADF Ultra Low Ash Diesel Engine Oil. It's time to kick some ash.
Hi everybody, welcome back to Equipment World. You're watching The Dirt. I'm your host, Brian, and today we're here to talk about one of the most overlooked parts of your equipment when it comes to regular maintenance. We're talking about the coolant system. Why is it important to pay attention to coolant and how to properly flush your coolant and what even coolant should you use? Here to talk with us today is Shelly Eckert with Chevron to give us some idea of how to properly maintain your coolant system. So my first question for you is, as a guy in the dirt industry that just is the typical Joe Schmo, my idea of cooling maintenance is going out there with my little float bubble thing and dipping a little radiator fluid into it and making sure that it's beyond the right freeze point and we call it a day. As the expert in the industry, what am I lacking in my maintenance?
Well, the first thing is using the floating bubble hydrometer. Over the years, I've gone out to shops and talked to the technicians, and these are very common to be found in the shops. However, the problem is the second that oil gets up into here, the floating balls do not read right.
Gotcha.
So for example, I walked into a shop and I had, four or five technicians, and they all had these. Well, this is what we use.
Industry standard. Absolutely.
All of us took a freeze point, a sample out of the cooling system, and we were all different. One was brand new, by the way. So I would always recommend that you use what we call a freeze point refractometer. Looks just like what we use for a percent urea for diesel exhaust fluid. There are refractometers on the market that can do both percent urea and a freeze point. They're very simple. They're used in all of the laboratories that test a freeze point. All you have to do is lift the shield, put a couple of drops of coolant on it, drop the shield, make sure it's covered, point to light source, and read it.
And is reading it pretty simple?
It is. I mean, there can be some complexity. Some of the refractometers can have a ethylene glycol and a propylene glycol and a battery scale on it, which most common in our industry for off-highway as well as on-highway, it is ethylene glycol.
Okay, so as long as you just ignore the other two, you're fine.
That's right. Ignore the other two.
Keep it simple. Now, I will ask you this. In your float ball situation, was the brand new float ball reading correctly with your refractometer?
It was close.
So it was close, but still you're not getting an accurate read.
You're not getting an accurate read.
Interesting. And yet that's the industry standard.
Well, it's not an industry standard. It's a default. But you can calibrate this with water. As long as it is room temperature water, whether that is coming from a faucet, bottled water, or even a stream. Water freezes at 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Throw it on here and there's a water line to make sure that it's reading appropriately.
Interesting. So that is very simple, very straightforward.
It is simple. And it's exactly what the lab uses. So you can get these from your lubricant provider or you can get them off of Amazon. But you want to get a nice, good quality one too.
Well, my next question for you is, as I come into the winter months, what questions as a contractor do I need to be asking about the coolant in my machine? I'm sure it goes above and beyond. Do we just need to top it off?
You need to start with checking that freeze point and making sure that it is accurate, right? You also need to make sure that you're checking all of your hoses and your clamps and pressure checking the radiator to make sure the cooling system, to make sure it's maintaining its pressure. Because if it's not, everything you're doing and checking the freeze point, it's a waste of time. If you change to the radiator cap, drive it around, recheck the pressure because the radiator caps can be inexpensive and can fail right out of the box. You know, we talk about winterization, right? As a key term. In my opinion, if you are doing a proper coolant maintenance program year round, you really don't need to be winterizing. Now, if you're using a conventional heavy duty coolant, you want to know what the difference is between a heavy duty conventional coolant and an extended life coolant.
What's that?
Heavy duty conventional coolant, the additives go in and create like a blanket on the cooling system. And when you put a blanket on yourself, what happens?
You get warmer.
And when you do an extended life coolant, your organic acids are floating around and then they go in and protect where cavitation starts. So you increase your heat transfer properties by about 10 or 12%.
Really?
Yes.
So if I understand that correctly, running an extended life coolant will help your system run cooler?
Yes.
Interesting.
Always a little bit more expensive because it's an extended life coolant, but sure. It's a longer life and less maintenance. All you really do is you need to check your freeze point. And I highly recommend to check the organic acids that are in your coolant, but you really need to start with understanding what is the coolant that you're using, whether that's, you know, a heavy duty conventional coolant, an extended life coolant. So you know what you're looking for. I like the freeze point to start with because that's the number one physical property. And then I recommend using a pH test strip.
Why pH test strips, out of curiosity?
But before we get into that, I want to take a second to tell you about the sponsor of this video, Chevron Lubricants. Protecting your diesel engine and its exhaust aftertreatment system has traditionally been seen as an either-or proposition when it comes to choosing the engine oil that's going to protect your system. And that's exactly why Chevron spent more than a decade of R&D work developing a no-compromise formulation. Now, I don't have to tell you why a clogged DPF is bad news, but here's the real kick in the pants. 90% of that ash clogging up your DPF and then upping your fuel and maintenance costs, it comes from your engine oil. You might be thinking, why don't they make an engine oil with less ash in it then? You'll be happy to learn that Chevron agrees with you. They've developed a new ultra-low ash diesel engine oil that is specifically designed to combat DPF ash clogging. Dello 600 ADF with OmniMax technology cuts sulfate ash by 60%, radically reducing the rate of DPF clogging and extending the DPF service life by 2.5 times. Before, you had to choose between protecting your engine or your aftertreatment system. Now you don't. Dello 600 ADF with OmniMax technology. It's time to kick some ash.
Why pH test strips, out of curiosity?
This is on the same scale as a universal scale. You've got a 0 to 14, right?
Yep.
With an extended life coolant, it's typically 8 to 9. When you're using a heavy duty conventional coolant, it's usually somewhere higher, like 12 maybe. If you've got too many nitrites in your cooling system, because that's the other thing with an extended life coolant, you have either a nitrate-free or a nitrated coolant. And that's really OEM specific as to what you can and cannot use.
Oh, okay.
But more on the off-highway, you're still going to see a variety of different coolants.
And don't mix them.
Don't mix them. You can mix up to 25%. Because of the dye situation on the market, once you start mixing two different coolants, you can't really tell what is 25%.
Sure, you just get to the right level of brown and then you're roughly there.
Well, no, brown's really bad.
Oh, sorry. Orangey green.
I have a comment about that. There is a rainbow of colors out there, and sure, the dyes mean nothing, to tell you the truth.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
So the whole adage of keep orange with orange and green with green doesn't actually mean anything?
Not really.
Gotcha.
In my opinion, right? So I've run into a fluorescent green coolant that we weren't sure what it was. And so I ran it through the lab and had all of the testing done. Because that's where you really want to do is send a sample into the lab, because they have all of the instrumentation. When you're talking about test strips out in the field, that's a quick test. That's it.
Sure.
And when in doubt, send it into the lab. But I ran this through the lab and it came back as a Japanese hybrid coolant. So it was completely compatible with our nitrite-free coolant. I was talking to the engineer about this Japanese hybrid coolant and it was green. And he said, when did it get changed from conventional? I said, I'm not the engineer. That's you.
So now what you're telling me is, like, we're the dumb dirt guys. We're not supposed to have to read labels and everything. We're supposed to use the colors and shapes game to figure this stuff out. And now you're telling me the colors aren't going to work.
Now, I mean, there's a guideline that's been put out with the Technology Maintenance Council that has changed over the years, but it came out after the extended life coolants were being put out there. And really, you know, red is deemed as being an extended life coolant, but I've seen red nitrate-free coolant, red long life coolant. You have to read the fine print that's in the documentation. I've seen a long life coolant that's on the market that's marketed as being a million mile coolant. And if you read the fine print, it says you have to re-additize every 150,000 miles. That's not extended life coolant. I've also seen where you go out to the shops and they're on an extended life coolant and they're still using SCAs or supplemental coolant additives, whether that's liquid or pre-charged filters, and that's commingling coolants. So for example, if you do have extended life coolant and you're trying to put in more additives, a lot of times you'll have an additive dropout. And you'll start to see, no other way to say this, but it's white flocculant.
I was going to say flocculation. Ah, I nailed my chemistry term. That's awesome.
Good way to visualize it. If you gargle with warm salt water and you put the salt into the water and you put too much salt in and it starts to accumulate at the bottom, that's white flocculant.
And really, that's all of the stuff that's supposed to be protecting your coolant system dropping out of solution, essentially.
That's exactly right, because the two atoms are fighting and they're going to fall out and you'll lose
protection. So it sounds to me that if you're one of these contractors, like myself, who uses the color system and maybe a little, you know, back alley chemistry to mix your coolants, it sounds like really to get onto a proper maintenance program, it's almost better to do a full coolant flush and put in 100% of something you know what it is so that you know exactly where your system stands.
I agree with that 100%. I don't want to be wasteful, but if you just buy a new piece of equipment that's been leased out and it comes back and it's not the normal color coolant that you currently use, yeah. I would just change it out and start over.
Okay. And then going forward, being all on the same page, you know exactly what's in your machine. Real maintenance from that point on forward. You're talking about doing your freeze check, and then you recommended pH strips. Anything else that I need to really be concerned about other than kind of topping off the system and making sure my freeze point's correct?
If you're using a conventional heavy-duty coolant, you want to make sure you have enough nitrate protection because those will deplete over time.
And how do I check that?
You can use a nitrate test strip that's on the market.
Oh, okay.
So you want to keep an eye on your cooling system, right? Also keeping in mind that 40% of engine-related failures are coolant-related. So coolant is not something that should be overlooked.
And yet it is so often. It's kind of an afterthought.
It is, because it's a lot of it. It was when extended life coolant came on the market, many of us were talking about how you can check it with your freeze point once or twice of the year. And that was fine back in the 90s. But when the EGR came on the market and technology changed on these pieces of equipment.
That's not the case anymore. So how does the EGR affect the cooling system?
Well, this is funny. When I was at the lab, we were seeing contaminants hitting in the engine oil. And then we were seeing contaminants hit the coolant where it was becoming acidic. And we weren't putting two and two together at first until we started seeing feedback from our customers. And then we realized, holy smokes, if the coolant is overconcentrated with glycol to the water mixture, the coolant will become more viscous, thicker, goes up into the EGR and will crack the EGR and cause gas go into the coolant and cause the coolant to become acidic.
Interesting.
So if you have an EGR problem, you'd better darn well check the coolant.
Good to know.
Which you can also use the pH test strip.
Yeah.
If it drops below 7, that's an indication that your coolant has become acidic. The one thing about the test strips, you want to make sure that they are color resistant because the dye can play around
with your results.
Yeah, that makes sense.
The newer the coolant, the more intense the dye is. It's not as accurate on brand new coolant, but it is accurate on in-service coolants.
Well, this has been super informational. Thank you, Shelly. I learned a lot today.
You're welcome. Thanks, Bryan.
Well, thanks again for Shelly coming on the show to give us an idea of how to properly maintain your coolant system on your equipment. 40% of engine failures are due to cooling system issues. I had no idea, and yet it's a largely overlooked portion of your equipment. Hopefully going forward, that's going to change due to the information Shelly was able to share with us today. So as always, I hope this has been helpful. You guys enjoy your holidays, and we'll catch you on the next Dirt.